Good evening to you. I do not know if you're joining us from abroad. I do not know the time, but anyway, good evening to you according to Sri Lankan time. Good to come to your homes. Last week, we could not come with the study because we had a power cut crisis here in Sri Lanka. We are going through a power cut crisis. So we couldn't bring the Bible study. We regret for that. But here we are this week here, bringing the word, and hope you are ready with your Bible and your pen or pencil or whatever and your book. And I hope that your heart is ready more than anything else. Shall we pray and start? Precious Holy Spirit of God, depending on you, leaning on you for everything. Without you, we can do nothing, Holy Spirit of God. And we ask that you help us to understand the scripture and to gather and receive what you're trying to speak to us today. The true message that you're trying to get it across to us. We want to receive it with humility and meekness and love. And thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are here in our midst. We want to glorify you and thank you that you are in the midst of every child of God who is listening to this study, that you are moving in their midst, walking in their midst, in their home, in that room, that you are ministering to them, touching them, healing them, transforming them, revealing your love to them, causing them to experience your unlimited love. Thank you that your love sets free many tonight. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Okay, so where we left last is that we started studying the second letter to the church in Smyrna. Am I right? That's where we stopped, and we looked at the testimony of Polycarp. I hope that you remember, because we lost 1 week and we lost touch. But that where we stopped is at the testimony of Polycarp. And Jesus said something beautiful to the Smyrna church, which I want you to look at. And that's where we're going to begin. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10. Okay, so we have finished Ephesus and we have come to Smyrna. And I revealed so much of information about the church in Smyrna. And verse 10, look what it's saying. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. So what is this 10 days? Also, Jesus is saying you will suffer for 10 days. It was a metaphor in those days to say it's a short time that you're going to suffer. Stay in there, hang in there, don't throw in the towel. It's going to be only for a short while. And then you're going to stand before me and you're going to receive rewards. You know, that's what Jesus is saying to the churches. Whatever that you're going through, whatever suffering that you're going through, whatever persecution that you're going through, whatever challenge that you're going through, it's going to be for a short while. If he spoke this to the Smyrna church, they went through, I revealed to you how much of things that they went through. You know, so much of information I gave you. And one thing, that Jesus didn't have anything against the Smyrna church, but he said, stay in there, persevere, in there. That was the command to the church in Smyrna. Life is like a movie. Different stages. That's what the church in Smyrna was going through. They were going through poverty, and then they were going through slandering, and then imprisonment, and even death for Christ. And I revealed, how the city of Smyrna in Ephesus was known for, martyrdom. And I revealed so much of information to you. And they stood the test, and some of the amazing testimonies of people who were martyred were amazing witness for Christ, and the stance and the stand they took for Christ were kind of testimonies we can look at and learn so much. And I believe the Smyrna church, I believe, stood the test of time and all what they went through for Christ. So we need to stand for Christ in everything what we're going through. Yes, challenges will come. Setbacks will come. Unexpected things will suddenly bang on you. You least expected. Oh, this, I never expected this to happen. You know, things, kind of things will come at you, but you cannot, you know, break down. You cannot be knocked off, knocked down. You need to move on. That's what Jesus was telling the church in Smyrna. Yes, Smyrna church went through a lot of setbacks and challenges, but they never stopped. They kept moving forward. And at the end, great rewards are waiting, precious people of God. At the end, great rewards are waiting for the church. At the rapture, after rapture, what is going to be in heaven is the reward ceremony for the churches. And it's going to be an amazing time. 2 Timothy, go with me to 2 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, Paul's words. I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me, what? The crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. So Paul is saying, I have fought a good fight of faith. Are you fighting a good fight of faith? Yes, I know some of you watching us, you're going through a challenging time. You have stood for Christ. You have took a stance for Christ, but still you're going through challenges. Still they are going through many setbacks and so much of tough times that you're going through. Fight a good fight of faith. Finish the race. Keep the faith intact. And Paul is saying, now there is in store for me the crown of life. You know, what we will get is after rapture at the award ceremony is crowns. Crowns are waiting for us. Crowns are given to rulers. Am I right? And we will rule with Christ. I taught you about, you know, the study in the rapture and taught you in detail about the crowns also. So this is why we must keep fighting a good fight of faith. And believers in the Smyrna church were doing that. And Jesus adds that the end of the letter. You know, Jesus is like executive director of the movie. And each of these letters, he gives a sneak preview of what is to come at the end of the movie. And believers in Smyrna, he says, those of you who overcome, those of you who endure, I will give you the crown of life. I will give you the crown of life. Can we go to Revelation chapter 2? Turn your Bibles to Revelation chapter 2. And verse 11, he says, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who is victorious will not be hurt all by the second death. Or let's take it from verse 10. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put you, some of you, in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you life as your victor's crown. It's called the crown of life. Why the crown of life is mentioned for the church in Smyrna because they gave their life for Christ. They died as martyrs for Christ, and that's why crown of life is waiting for you. Because Paul knew that he's going to be martyred. That's why he's saying, I have the crown of life for me. And precious child of God, what an honor, you know, to serve God and die for him. There's no greater honor than that. So this is a very significant statement for the people in Smyrna. What, I will give you the crown of life. Because the crown was the symbol of the city of Smyrna. Do you know that? Crown was the symbol of the city of Smyrna. Crowns were on their coins. Crowns, what people got those days when they got a victory. Or at great festivals, everyone would wear a garland of crown. Emperors wore crowns, and the Christians had no crowns in Smyrna city. Certainly, they were not allowed to participate in games. They were not allowed in festivals. They were not allowed in emperor's courts. They were totally outcasts. They never had crowns. They only had rejections and rebukes. But Jesus says, hang in there, I will give you the crown of life. What's the point of having a crown on earth, precious people of God? Those are temporary. The crowns that we get in heaven are eternal. And it's worth paying for it. Amen? And that's what Jesus was saying to the church in Smyrna. So Jesus says, hang in there, I will give you the crown of life. So for Christians in Smyrna, it was not game over. It was game on. Here we come for the crown of life. You know, that's the life that the Christians in church in Smyrna, they lived. So I believe they strongly believed in what Paul wrote. Paul himself was martyred. He said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is definitely gain. So Jesus said, overcome, great is your reward. Great is your reward. Precious children of God, let's remember and focus our life for the eternal rewards, not the temporal ones. Oh, today many are striving for the temporal rewards that comes from the world. But we as the children of God, we need to strive for the eternal rewards, eternal crowns that are coming from Jesus. You know, today, there are people, even right now in the century that we are living in, have decided that they are not going to, compromise on following Christ or break their commitment to Christ. Even it happened in those days in the city of Smyrna, AD somewhere in 93, 94, or later on even. But even today, precious people of God, you know how many have been killed for following Christ? Actually, in Afghanistan, how many are killed? The news does not come out. Many are killed for the sake of following Christ. There are people paying price right now. Of following Christ, they will get the crown of life. So don't live a compromised life. Examples are these Christians in the city of Smyrna. The church in the city of Smyrna was an example to us. And today also many Christians in many parts of the world are going through tribulation, slander, and poverty. And even death for Christ, for the sake of Christ. So it's extremely relevant even in our times, precious people of God. So these people have such deep conviction, such deep-rooted faith in Jesus Christ. They literally experience Christ, and the Holy Spirit of God made Jesus so real to them. That's why they were able to take a stance for Jesus, even to give their life for Christ. We need to come to that place of Holy Spirit making Jesus so real to us. And He can make Jesus so real to us so that we can literally walk with Him in these present times and live for Him. You believe with me, shout an amen. So, are you willing to stand for Christ and know that He is with you and know that great is the reward for the price that you're paying for believing in Christ? Amen. So what is the lesson that we learn from Smyrna? The lesson that we learned from Ephesus is, let's not lose our first love. And from Smyrna, what we are learning is, let's persevere and walk for Christ, never compromise. Let's not live a compromised life. Let's live for Christ. That's what we are learning from the church, the letter written to the church in Smyrna. Amen. So what you take from the letter written to the church in Smyrna is, in the face of persecution, trials and troubles and hardship, I will never disown Christ. I will never deny Christ. Even to the extent of giving my life for Christ, I will continue. I will persevere. I will stand the test. I will continue to pay the price for Christ. I am even willing to die for Him. That's what Christ is demanding from the church, from the church of Smyrna. He pre-warned them, and the Christians there didn't abandon the church and run away. They stood the test. People like Polycarp and some other believers, you know, they stood the test. They faced the challenge head on. They proved that Christ is the important person in their life. Christ takes the first place in their life. They proved it. Not a compromised life, not a double standard life. They lived steadfast, one-minded life for Christ. And that is what the lesson that we learn from the church, letter written to the church in Smyrna. Don't live a compromised life, precious people of God. Don't lose your first love. That is the letter, learn from the letter to Ephesus. And don't live a compromised life. That's what we learn from the letter written to Smyrna. Okay, so let's go to the letter in Pergamum. Sean, I don't know at what time did we start. Let's see, 1:40, okay. Right, so I need to see what time I must finish, okay. Right, so let's go to the letter to the church of Pergamum. Okay, can we go to Revelation chapter 2, verse 12 to verse 17. Okay, so let's read the letter and then dive into the study about Pergamum. To the angel of the church in Pergamum write, these are the words of him who has the sharp double-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Nevertheless, I have few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Verse 15. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Verse 16. Repent therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give the person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it. Amazing, isn't it? So today, let's look at what is Pergamum City. I always give you a background to the city before we go into the letter in detail. Am I right? We looked at what is Ephesus City. We looked at in detail what is the city of Smyrna, their background, and what is, their history and all of that, and what was happening in the city. And then the letter makes more sense to us. So let's look at what is Pergamum City. Okay, all of these cities were in Asia Minor, which is the present Turkey, all of these seven churches. The Pergamum is one of the best excavated city of the Roman world. Pergamum is one of the best excavated city of the Roman world. I miss Vijit a lot. You know, I used to discuss a lot about him. He's a man so passionate for the word. We used to discuss, scriptures for long hours, and he used to ask me questions. He had such passion for the word. I miss him a lot. Pergamum is one of the best excavated city of the Roman world. And the city of Pergamum was built on a hill 1,000 feet above the surrounding countryside, creating a natural fortress. So Pergamum had a natural fortress kind of thing because it was built on a 1,000 feet above the sea level, on a hill, this city, Pergamum, was built. And it is one of the best excavated city of the Roman world. And do you know that Pergamum had a very sophisticated library during that time, because it was a center of Greek culture and education. And the library had about 200,000 volumes of books. Not such a big library at that time. You know, it's amazing. And one of the stunning sights of Pergamum is the Hellenistic theater with the capacity of 10,000 for its attendees. So just imagine a huge stadium. Even at that time, they are built the Hellenistic theater. That was in Pergamum, and that was one of the sites when people visited Pergamum. And also, precious people of God, Pergamum was the throne of Satan. Because we read in the letter, you go with me to Revelation chapter 2, verse 13. I know where you live. Jesus says, I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Okay, now if you go again to verse 13, I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. So Satan had his throne in Pergamum. I will explain why Jesus called Satan, it's the throne of Satan. You know, Pergamum was a city which was the throne of Satan. Okay, I will explain to it. Satan ruled the city of Pergamum, because where you have a throne, that's where you rule. Am I right? Kings have their throne and kings rule that place. So Pergamum was a city ruled by Satan. You know, in your country, do you know there are certain places are ruled by demons, ruled by Satan? When it comes to Sri Lanka, Katharagama, the place, ruled by demons and the devil, even Kandy. You know, there are places where the demonic manifestation and demonic inhabitation are more, the activity of demons are more, and Satan kind of have a hold of that place and rules that place. Can you remember Jesus went to Gadara to deliver that man who called himself Legion? And can you remember those demons asked Jesus, please don't send us from this place? Because yeah, that's the place they are so comfortable, because they rule that place. And that's why people in that place chased away Jesus. And they said, please go away from this city. Because that place, even the people were influenced by the devil. Devil was ruling that place. That's why they didn't want people, didn't want Jesus. They said, immediately leave. So Pergamum was such a kind of city where Satan had his throne. Okay. Why do Jesus say that Satan had his throne? Is because Pergamum, hear me well, was the center of four idolatrous cults. No? Four prominent cults operated from the city of Pergamum. That's why Jesus called Satan's throne is in Pergamum. Pergamum was another city with a lot of temples for the Roman gods, simple G gods. There were a lot of temples in Pergamum for simple G gods. The Romans had so many gods and goddesses. And Pergamum was one city that, hosted these gods and goddesses. Nearly every major deity had a temple in Pergamum. You name a very important Roman deity, that deity had a temple in Pergamum. That's how strong fortress it was, the devil's strong fortress. Pergamum. Just imagine a church existing in a city like that. How much of resistance they would have had. How much of spiritual warfare they would have had to go through. In terms of gods and your prayers to be answered, simple G gods, in terms of simple G gods, and your prayers to be answered, Pergamum was a hot spot. People from all over the world at that time used to come to Pergamum. And you will have all the gods to answer you. You know, that's the kind of, the reputation Pergamum city had. You want your prayers to be answered? Come to Pergamum city. It's kind of a tourist attraction. You need prayer, you need answer, come to Pergamum city. We have all the deities to answer any kind of prayer. That's kind of a reputation Pergamum carried. The array of gods and goddesses was the center of attraction of this city. You're getting what I'm saying. The center. Now, Sri Lanka has so many attraction, tourist attraction. What the tourist attraction or to attract people all over the world to the Pergamum city, the main thing was the temples. The temples of different gods and goddesses. In those days, Pergamum city was known for that. You know, the ancient altar of Zeus was a famous spot in Pergamum. There was a mountain, and in that mountain was the ancient altar of the god called Zeus. Oh, it was a famous attraction spot in Pergamum. Zeus was the king of the Mount Olympus. You know, there was a mountain in Pergamum which was called the Mount Olympus, and Zeus was the king of the mountain where all the gods and goddesses lived. So in this mountain, there were all kinds of array of gods and goddesses who lived. That mountain is called the Mount Olympus. And who was the king of that mountain was Zeus. And he's called the King of Kings. And he was the king of that mountain. And he was the king of kings for citizens of Pergamum. And Zeus was the god of sky. lightning and thunder with which he strikes his enemies. That's the belief that they had. So you had an enemy, you wanted to destroy your enemy, you come to Pergamum. That kind of promotion they was to give. And visit the ancient altar of Zeus, who's the god of sky, lightning and thunder. And you present your prayer at the altar, and King of Kings, Zeus, will kill your enemy. You know, this kind of things were promoted in Pergamum. So just imagine how much of intimidation the church in Pergamum would have had. How much of discomfort of being in that city. You know, according to the beliefs of the Pergamum, if you want anything to be done, that was the altar to go. Which altar? The ancient altar of Zeus. He was considered the King of Kings. He had all the power. That's what they believed. That's what he was called, the King of Kings. And the citizens of Pergamum and people who gathered from all over the world believed that Zeus had all the power to do anything what they asked. If somebody visited Pergamum for pleasure, they would say, why not visit the temple of Dionysius? Dionysius. There was a temple called Dionysius, a god called Dionysius. So somebody who came to Pergamum city for pleasure, they would say, visit the temple of Dionysius. He was the god of wine and revelry. You know, lively noise festivals with large amount of alcohols are served in this temple. And, you know, it's a festive place. It's called the god of wine and revelry. His name was God Dionysius. So somebody who's visiting Pergamum for pleasure will never miss this temple, the temple of Dionysius, you know, where there's a lot of wine and party and revelry. Going to the temple of Dionysius is like walking or going to Las Vegas. You know what kind of a city it is. It's a party city. It's a party place. People all over the world came to Pergamum to visit the temple of Dionysius to have party. It was day and night party place. People used to get drunk, even they lose their life because the parties go to such an extent level of hike, you know, people lose their life. And it was a blessing for them to die in that temple after party. Can you see the foolish beliefs people have? Even today in the 21st century, people have some weird kind of beliefs. And this was the belief that they had in Pergamum. Then if it is about food and good crops, if somebody comes to Pergamum about food and good crops, you need to go to the temple of Goddess Demeter. There was another temple called Goddess Demeter. And you have come to Pergamum city and it's about food and crops and your cultivation and all of that. They would divert you and say, why not visit the temple Goddess Demeter? And she's the god who can guarantee food on your table and a good crop at the end of every season. That's what they believed. And maybe you are sick and you came to Pergamum. There was a temple of the god Asclepion. Asclepion, you know, is the god of healing. So you come to Pergamum city, people from all over the world. You know, Pergamum was considered kind of a healing center. People with different sickness from all over the world thronged into the city of Pergamum to visit the temple of Asclepion. Asclepion is the god of healing. You know, the temple of Asclepion was one of the major spots for healing in the world at that time. Pilgrims came from all over the world to this temple. temple of Asclepion, God of healing. You know, in this temple, this is all what I've researched and studied and found out when I'm presenting it to you. You also can go and do this research and find more, even more greater details than what I'm revealing. You know, in this temple, it was snakes that did the healing. Can you believe? In the temple of Asclepion, it's a temple of healing. And who did the healings, according to the beliefs of the Pergamum people, is the snakes. Okay. The priest in the temple would put the people into a trance. Okay, they would go to sleep and then they would get a vision of what is wrong with them. And then they would take it to the doctor for treatment. So that is one kind of thing that happened. You know, the priest in this temple, people who come sick and they do not know what do they have and what kind of a sickness that the doctors cannot diagnose. And doctors can't find out what is wrong with that person. When they come to this temple of Asclepion, what the priest would do is put them to a trance. And then when they go into this trance, they were revealed what kind of sickness they had. And then they were given a diagnosis sheet, and they would take it to the doctor and the doctor would treat. And obviously, you know, who gives sickness is the devil. And then why can't he reveal? You know, he's the one who gives and he's the one who reveals. So nothing big about it. So that is one of the things that is done in the temple of Asclepion. Okay. And also, they would put the people into a trance and put them in a pitch dark room the whole night. What the other thing that the priest in this temple would do is put these people into a trance and put them in a dark, pitch dark room the whole night. And in the night, what they do is to release the snakes, okay, to crawl over their bodies. It's kind of a ritual of healing. A ritual of healing. This was practiced in the temple of Asclepion. Interestingly, you know, I was thinking, even today, the medical symbol we see is a rod and a snake. Am I right? How many of you have watched the WHO symbol, World Health Organization symbol? If you see, you see a stick and a snake. Am I right? So I do not know, you know, whether it's all started back in Pergamum, because they used snake to heal people. And it's demonic, precious people of God. Yes, people received healing. And even today, a lot of people use demonic powers to heal people. But that healing is not permanent. Know that. If you receive a healing from a demonic power, something else and something worse will break loose later on. He will give you and take something else. That's what the devil does. He will give you and he will rob something else. He will always keep you a slave to him. And that's how demonic powers does. So they did all of this with the demonic powers. So these are the temples that were prevailing and that they were operating in the city of Pergamum. And then if you need wisdom, you know, when people needed wisdom, you don't know what to do, you need wisdom, come to the temple of Athena. You know, there was a temple of the goddess Athena. You know, and what the Pergamum people believed is she was the goddess of wisdom. The goddess who would understand and build a great military strategy for the Rome during its wars. That's what the Romans believed. Goddess Athena would be the god of wisdom who will build strategies, wise strategies for the Roman army to win battles. That's what they believed in Pergamum. you know, goddess Athena. You know, if you want to affirm Caesar as the Lord of Lords, Savior of your life, granting you peace and safety, then you would come to the temple of the imperial cult upon the top of the mountain, the temple of Trajan. You know, the temple of Trajan was imperial cult, temple of imperial cult, which was dedicated to Caesar. You know, so these are the temples, you know, that prevailed in the Pergamum city. Just imagine what kind of a environment that would have been in the Pergamum city, a Christian to be in a Pergamum city. So much of a demonic influence. So this was the setup in Pergamum. If you are a follower of Jesus, and if you refuse to bow your knees, you know, you're going to pay the price. You're going to pay a price for being a follower of Jesus Christ. And it was good to hear what Jesus said at the beginning of the letter. What did Jesus say at the beginning of the letter? Verse 13. Verse 13. He said, I know where you live. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Now you understand why Jesus said Satan has his throne in Pergamum, because all of his main, you know, agents were there in the city of Pergamum. All those goddesses and gods who represented him, virtually when they worship these gods and goddesses, they're worshiping the devil. So people all over the world thronged into Pergamum city to only visit these temples. These temples had thousands and thousands of devotees coming from all over the world and worshiping the devil in the Pergamum city. That's why Jesus called it is the throne of Satan. Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas. My faithful witness was put to death in your city where Satan lives. So, you need to understand how challenging it is to live for Christ in Pergamum. How challenging it is to live for Christ in Pergamum. You know, let's just picture this. I was imagining, let's picture this. If someone from Pergamum came to Jerusalem, a Jew, let's say a Jew came from Pergamum to Jerusalem, and during Pentecost there was this revival and you know, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit of God, and then he had an encounter with the Holy Spirit of God and his life changed and he got water baptized, and then, you know, he's full of the fire of the Holy Spirit, and then this Jew returns back to city of Pergamum, okay, and now when he comes back, just imagine the challenges that he has to face for being a disciple of Jesus Christ, being a follower of Jesus. Now, when he comes, you know, he will see what he has heard in Jerusalem is Christ is our wisdom. The whole wisdom of God is hidden in Christ. And he has heard now Christ is the Prince of Peace and safety. Now you know that he knows that Christ is our ultimate healer. You know, all of these encounter with all of this revelational knowledge, if this person who had encountered Christ and had a revelation and is returning back to Pergamum, now he has to make a claim of Jesus Christ and say, Jesus is the King of Kings, not Zeus. He has to say, Jesus is the source of ultimate supply of everything, not Dionysius. Jesus is the true provider, not Demeter. He is the fullness of wisdom, not Athena. And he is the healer, not Asclepion. You know, he has to declare that. He has to acknowledge that. He has to vocalize that. You know, these Christians, were considered as God deniers in Pergamum. They were thrown into the category of atheists who do not believe in gods. You know, they were thrown out of synagogues, thrown out of the worship places, and they were persecuted so much. This was the challenge that the early Christian was going through in the Pergamum city. It was, you know, almost in every city, it was intense persecution, intense suffering for the sake of Christ. So being a follower of Christ in Pergamum was a really high-risk adventure, precious child of God. It was a really, really high-risk adventure. It threatens your personal comfort, your personal peace, relationship with family members and friends, your prosperity, your properties and possessions were confiscated, and you were just left with nothing in that city. And you are just left to survive on your own. This was what the Pergamum church was going through. So there is no part of your life, in your life, was not touched by the stance for Christ in midst of all these gods and goddesses. In fact, your very life was at risk. In the letter, Jesus recognizes Antipas. Did you notice that? That is already martyred for his faith. We do not know. I searched about Antipas and I didn't get any much information. Somebody called Antipas has been in the city of Pergamum, and he was martyred for the faith in Christ. And Jesus is acknowledging him. Jesus is acknowledging him and honoring him. So the Roman governor of that region had his headquarters in Pergamum. The Roman governor of that region had his headquarters in Pergamum. Now it was said that he had the right to the sword. This is the word that was used in Pergamum. The governor had the right to the sword. This is a kind of a phrase that they use in Pergamum. In other words, every case brought before him, he would say either they live or die by the sword. No? So most probably many Bible scholars believe that Antipas was probably put to death by the sword of the governor for his stance for Christ. So Jesus commends these Christians that even in the face of Antipas' death, they held fast to the name of Jesus. Can you see that? He says, yet you remain true to my name. I know where you're living. That's where Satan's throne is. Yet you have remained true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. So Jesus. And there had been Christians who stood for Jesus in the midst of martyrdom, even in the city of Pergamum, precious people of God. And sometimes when I, you know, read this Bible, these scriptures, and in my personal devotion times, I used to think how it would be in our nation, Sri Lanka, if these kind of things happen. How will the church survive? Will the church stand the test of time? Will Christians be bold and courageous? Will Christians, the children of, will they be like believers in Pergamum, yet remaining true to the name of Jesus? We need to think this: how steadfast, how faithful these Christians have been. Because of them, Christianity has, you know, evolved, and you know, it has spread all over the world, and even it has come to Sri Lanka. And we are following Christ We have become children of God because of the price the early Christians paid. They never denied Christ. Amen. That's off to them. You know, there was a hymn that the early Christians sang probably in Pergamum. It is recorded in Philippians chapter 2. You know, this is the song they sang. God had highly exalted Jesus Christ and given him a name that is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue should confess to the glory of the Father. It's one of the song that they sing. You know, Christians believe that. They would not let go his name. Jesus praised them for that. Jesus praised them for that. And that's one thing that we learn from the letter written to the church in Pergamum, that they never denied the name of Christ. But that was not true to everyone, precious child of God. Not every believer. Some people in the church in Pergamum were tired of being different. Tired of being excluded. They didn't like the danger and discomfort of following Christ. Some, not all Christians. There were few who never denied the name of Christ, but there were other people in the church. They didn't like of being in discomfort. They didn't like of being differently treated. They're tired of being excluded by following Christ. So they wanted to be part of the other society. They wondered whether there could be a way to compromise, to release the pressure. So there was another community in the church, another group of people who didn't want to endure the test, who didn't want to go through all of these things, and they were looking a way for compromising. So there was one way, what? Sneaking back into the temples of these pagan gods and worship and still be Christians. You know, that's the only way out they had. So they were in the church, but they were compromising and entertaining the world into their life while being Christians. There was another two groups. One group was so steadfast, they never denied Christ and they lived for Christ and believed in his name and never compromised. And there was another group in the church in Pergamum. They wanted a compromised life. They could not endure the test. Now Jesus was saying, some of you are practicing sexual immorality and eating food sacrificed to idols. You know, leave alone sexual immorality. Jesus was saying you're doing sexual immorality as a worship to other deities. You know, it happened. People who come from all over the world, they used to sleep. The temples used to have temple prostitutes. And sleeping with the temple prostitutes, it was an act of worship to that deity. So Jesus is not only saying you are committing sexual immorality, he's saying you are doing sexual immorality as an act of worship to the other deities. Dangerous, isn't it, people of God? And there are some in the Pergamum church, some Christians were doing to compromise and be in the good books of the citizens of Pergamum. And that's what Jesus was saying. And that's why in verse 14, he says, nevertheless, I have few things against you. There are some among you. Can you see? There are some among you inside the church. So to release the pressure, some of the believers gave in to these practices and denied Christ. Jesus compares these Christians to the Jews during the prophet Balaam's time. You know, because Jesus says, nevertheless, I have few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teachings of the Nicolaitans. So I told you, who are Nicolaitans? is that the believers in the Ephesian church rejected Nicolaitans. Who are Nicolaitans? Who compromise, who bring the world inside the church, who live double standard life. They compromise. They live in sin while being in Christians. They embrace all kind of evil, ugly, immoral practices and while being Christians. And they say it is okay. And this kind of group was inside the Pergamum church. There was one group that ardently followed Christ and lived purely and wholly for Christ. And they were never denying Christ's name. But there was another group who were following the teachings of Nicolaitans. What is the teachings of Nicolaitans? Is the teaching of Balaam. What did Balaam do? I taught you some time back also. Balaam gave a teaching, an idea to Balak, the Moabite king, to entice the Israelites to indulge in sin. What is the sin they did? They sexually got involved with the Moabite women, and those Moabite women took them to the gods Baal in their country, and did immoral sexual activities in the Baal temple as an act of worship to Baal, and also ate the food sacrificed to the idols. And that is the same thing the believers in the Pergamum church was doing. They were compromising and sneaking into these temples and doing all of those practices, and then come back on Sunday and sit and, you know, pretend like they are genuine Christians. And Jesus says, I see everything. I see everything. And don't you think this is happening even today in our churches? Jesus says, I know everything. I see everything. So the problem in the church of Pergamum was not that the church was... Okay. Sean says 1 hour, time up. Okay, so I'll say this and I'll close, because more than 1 hour, your concentration levels goes here and there. So maximum 1 hour, 1 hour is more than enough. So hear me well, church. The problem in the church of Pergamum was not that the church was in Pergamum, but too much of Pergamum was inside the church. That's the main problem of the church in Pergamum. What is the main problem? The Pergamum church was not in Pergamum. Not only it was in Pergamum, but the problem was the Pergamum, the practices of the Pergamum city was inside the church of Pergamum. Can I read it again? The problem in the church of Pergamum was not that the church was in Pergamum, but too much of Pergamum was inside the church. This is why we need to be very careful that we don't bring the worldly practices inside the church. Whatever we do in the church, first we need to look at and see whether it is accepted by the Lord. Because it is endorsed by the world and highly elevated by the world and entertained by the world, it doesn't mean we need to accept it in the church. We need to weigh everything, place it before the Holy Spirit of God and ask, is it endorsed by you? Is it accepted by you, Holy Spirit of God? Because that was the major problem in the Pergamum church. There were two groups of people, one compromised and one uncompromised. And Jesus saw this. And let's stop there and continue next week with the Pergamum church. You know, so we are learning. Why are we learning? The letters, what is written to these churches, we need to look at it and see whether we have that in our life and correct ourselves. That's why we are learning these letters. As these letters have been read and taught, the Holy Spirit will convict you. And when the Holy Spirit convicts, don't resist him. Repent. One of the words in these letters, seven letters, one of the words that's repeated by Jesus is repent, repent, repent. No? So if you are convicted because of what is spoken from this table of grace through the letter written to the churches. Church, we need to repent and return to the right place and start walking with the Lord all over again. He does not condemn, he convicts. And when he convicts, it is our responsibility to repent and return back. Amen. So that's why Jesus wrote these letters and he said, I see these wrong things in you. Repent and return so that I am back again with you. Start doing mighty things through you. So we are learning. Ephesian church, we learned what? Let's return to our first love. In Myrna church, what did we learn? Endure the persecution. Be steadfast, immovable, ever abounding in following Christ. That's what we learn. And Pergamum, what we are learning is never compromise. Don't entertain the doctrine of Nicolaitans, bringing the world into the church and compromising. Let's learn some more next week. Hoping to see all those who will come for the fasting and prayer time on Saturday. We need to get together and pray. Thank you everyone who come every Saturday, close to about 20 to 28 people, 28, 29 people. We gather together and pray. And if you are free on Saturday from 6 onwards, most probably go for about 1.5 hours. We pray together. We get into rooms and we pray together and everyone contributes towards praying. And I would invite you, if you have free time on Saturday, 6 to 7:30, please do join us. Let's come together and pray. You know, very, very important. We are living in a lot of difficult times, perilous times. This is the time the church must stand in the gap and pray. My house shall be called the house of prayer. Amen. And the church, the early church was birthed through prayer. Do you know that? The disciples, the 120, were praying fervently in one mind, one spirit, one accord in the upper room. And the church was birthed. Church was birthed through prayer. And Jesus called his house should be a house of prayer. And we need to personally pray. Also, corporately, we must come together and pray. Amen. So looking forward to see all those who join on Saturday. Thank you so much for patiently, you know, patience is a virtue that we need to develop. And without patience, we cannot be good Bible students. That's why many don't join the Bible study. They want only the, you know, what, the appetizer, Sunday sermon. If you have the patience, you're going to become a matured child of God by learning in patience. Amen. Thank you so much for joining this evening. Such a joy to come to your homes with the living scriptures of the Holy Spirit of God and teaching you many truths. I count it as a great, great, great privilege. So let's close in prayer. Father, we want to say thank you for speaking to us through the letter written to Ephesus, church in Ephesus, and church in Smyrna, and church in Pergamum. We are learning a lot, Holy Spirit of God, and we are, Lord, fine-tuning our walk with you, Holy Spirit of God, so that we can see powerful manifestation of your presence in our midst. That's what we hunger for. Thank you that you will raise up as a church, sanctified and separated for you, to reveal your glory in these last days. Sanctify every son and daughter who is listening to these words earnestly, and Lord, with a passion and a desire. Transform their lives. Lord, bring about a 360-degree change in the lives of any son and daughter who has compromised, who has allowed sin to dominate in their life. Today, let there be repentance in their heart and returning back to God. Father, if someone is repenting, let your love come and fill their heart and mind. Let your embrace be felt by them. Thank you that you will draw them to you, that they will start walking upright, blameless and righteous before you, God. Lord, cleanse the churches. Cleanse the churches here in Sri Lanka. And Lord, send a refiner's fire. Lord, from the head to every sheep in the pew, cleanse with refiner's fire, God. Let your church be sanctified, purified, separated from the world to reveal your true glory, Father. Lord, let the latter glory of the church will be greater than the former glory of said, and let the churches here in Sri Lanka walk with the latter glory of you walking in the midst of holy people, Lord. Lord, you're a holy God, and you walk among the people who are holy, and refine the church. Send the refiner's fire. Send the cleansing flood, Lord, into the church. Purify and prune the church and prepare the church to be spotless and blameless holy bride when you come, Lord Jesus. Do it with all the churches in Sri Lanka, we pray. And Lord, if there is any child of God who is under the sound of your voice, who has allowed to compromise to set in, lukewarmness to come in, worldliness to come in, allowed the worldliness to creep in, and the doctrine of Lord Balaam or the Nicolaitans have crept into their life, uproot it, Holy Spirit of God, even as they repent right now. If the Holy Spirit of God is convicting you, precious child of God, repent, 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 and return to the loving hands of your loving Father. He loves you, He loves you, He loves you. He will embrace you, take you. He will give you a new garment of righteousness. He will give you a new authority of ring, and He will give you all the privileges and the blessings. He will not withhold it from you. You are blessed. Repent and return to the Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed evening, a blessed week, and also hope to see you on Sunday. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you be my light when I cannot see? And when I can't take another step, Lord, will you carry me? And when I've lost my fight, will you be my strength? And will you set me a table in the presence of my enemies? I shall not walk. I shall not want. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. 'Cause my cup's running over, and I shall not want. And I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. And I won't be afraid of the shadow, 'cause I've seen the sun. No, I will not stop when the way gets hard, 'cause the green only grows in the valley, and that's where you are. Say it. I shall not walk. No, no, I shall not walk. Hey. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley. I shall not walk. Oh, I shall not walk. Oh, I shall not walk. 'Cause my cup's running over. 'Cause my cup's running over, running over, and I shall not. when this life is over, I'm gonna live again. I'm gonna trade this cross for a crown. No, this is not the end. And when you call my name, I will take my right. There's a mansion in glory, and you're gonna meet me there. I shall not walk. I shall not walk. He will wipe every tear from my eyes. I shall not want. I shall not want. When he's on my side, I shall not want. I'll be home in his presence forever. I shall not want. For the Lord is my shepherd in the valley. For the Lord is my shepherd when I'm lacking. For the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. I've got everything that I need. Your goodness and your mercy is following me. Got everything that I have. Hey, 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 hey. Your goodness and your mercy.